We love him. We respect him because we know of his walk with God. Our hearts are open, Brother Arnold. You have taken us to the throne. You have shown us the master on many occasions. And we know tonight that we're going to take another journey with you. Come open your heart. We're ready to hear the voice of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I know it's been a long day, but it's been a nice one. And I know that you're probably tired, but I'm not. And if you'll just remain standing for just a moment, then I'll get into the ministry of the Word of the Lord. And I would like to thank everybody who loves me. And who has said kind things, all the wonderful Gainesville people that are here and that are home, uplifting me and praying for me. And I thought Billy Cole seemed so funny today, as usual, when he was talking about having to follow Sister Mangan in the lineup that was there. Consider my dilemma. I have followed them all. And the unusual feeling that I have had in that they teamed me up with none other than C.M. Becton. C.M. Becton, in my opinion, is Mr. Clean.
And I'm the swamp rat. I'm going to tell you what he didn't touch, I'm fixing to take care of. Billy Cole told us today, if the Lord told you, you better say the Lord told me and the Lord better have told you. Isn't that what he said? Read my lips. The Lord has talked to me. I read in your hearing from the book of Acts, chapter 3. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah, hallelujah. And I as I told the group Monday night last year when I got to preach here, I was very honored and blessed of the Lord, and apparently the ball went out of the park, and I broke my bat. And I come here not in competition with myself of last year. And I hope that you are not expecting me to wow you. Hearing from the Lord is not always nice, but it's always best. One fellow said, "Is there any word from the Lord?" And the preacher said, "Yeah, you're going to die." Now, I can't promise you anything but truth. Okay, let's read. I'm in Acts chapter 3, and we know, I think sometimes the story, Peter and John went up together in the temple, the hour of prayer being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked in alms, and Peter, fastening his eyes upon him, said, "Look on us." He gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them.
And Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none. Such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand, lifted him up. Immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. He leaping up, stood and walked, and entered in with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew it. It was he that sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. I want you to notice this word in verse 11. "And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John." Peter and John were not posing for pictures. They were not signing autographs. They were trying to get away from the dude to go pray. I don't think you just heard me. If this man had not restrained them, they would have been gone. Kind of different with us. Chapter 4, verse 7, "And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, By what power, or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, Ye rulers of people, elders of Israel, we this day be examined the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole. Be it known unto you and all, and you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you've crucified, whom God hath raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is this salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. What a pedigree. Stupid but powerful. What a reversal we have. We have educated and empty. We can spell but can't snatch them up. They took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Beholding the man which was healed standing, they could say nothing against it. When they had commanded them to go aside of the council, they conferred among themselves, and you'll be sitting in just a minute, saying, "What shall we do to these men? For that indeed a notable miracle hath been done by them is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it." I do not have a sermon, and I don't even think I have a message. I got a lot of notes, but I don't think I have either one of them. But I do have three words that the Holy Ghost spoke to me a week ago on Saturday night when I was agonizing in prayer to preach this conference. And the Lord spoke to me just like Brother Becton said. And the Lord said to me three words: unexplainable, but undeniable. Challenged my people that it's my desire for them to enter into a place where things among them are unexplainable, yet undeniable. Father, bless the ministry of the Word and help me to do a great job. Help me not to be long-winded, but to say what needs to be done. And Lord, we're looking for the unexpected. We're looking for a demonstration of the mighty power of God. I pray that you curb this leaving on our mind spirit and our tiredness. Just touch us and help me to do a lot in a little bit of time. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. God bless you. Praise God. Praise God.
Praise God. I'm going to make you preach with me. Praise God. Now, I preached with all you cats, and I sung with all you, and I juked around with everybody here. And I'm just going to tell you like I always tell you. If you get on your feet for a guitar, my God, you'll be on your head for a preacher. Music will make you feel better, but preaching will save you. Preaching will change you. Preaching will bring the glory of God down. The transforming power, the regenerating force of the nature of God. Do you hear me out there, Radio Land? This is the voice of truth. We're fixing to have something that you can't explain, but you can't deny. You'll be seated a second here. Don't pay attention to them. Like priests, like people. Like shepherd, like sheep. I'm crazy and they're crazy. I'm saved and they're saved. I'm excited and they're excited. You want to get your people excited? Why don't you get excited? Why don't you dance? Why don't you shout? Why don't you talk in tongues? Why don't you worship with everything that's in you? You hear me, Radio Land? This is the voice of truth. You can be seated for a minute. You hear me now? Don't you worry. Ain't nobody taking this away from me. You can shout all you want to, but I have heard three words. I didn't steal it from a tape. Didn't read in somebody's dumb book. Unexplainable. Yet undeniable. We've talked about revival, talked about all this jazz today, and it's all good and fantastic. But God wants me to tell us, there are too many services and too many churches among us that everything can be explained. There's lots of churches with choirs. There's lots of churches with organs. There's lots of churches with talent. There's lots of churches that got this and got that. But God's church, the apostolic church, it ought to be something you can't explain. It ought to be something. It ought to be something that erupts. It ought to be something that burns like fire. Sit down a second here. I'm going as fast as I can. Now you hear me. Which great genius among us today can even dare try to explain the jazz that's going on among us? Who could dare explain the murders and the rapes and the abortions and the drug wars and the perversions and the fags and the queers and the Twinkies? And the injustice and the corruption in government and in just society general. Who can explain the decadence and the immorality? Who would have ever believed the Berlin Wall would come down? Romania would be in revolt. Russia would be in upheaval. Who can explain that Noriega's falling? I'm going to tell you.
The reason why people are acting in an unexplainable fashion is they have given themselves over to let evil spirits work with them. You missed it. Their actions are declaring that they are in union with evil spirits. What's going to happen when the church decides to let the Holy Spirit operate in them? It's going to be unexplainable. It's going to be unexplainable, but it's going to be undeniable.
It is time for the unexplainable to erupt from the spirit realm into our realm. You hear me now? Our generation is cursed by the explainable, the provable, and everything must be factual. Now, you're the bishop, Doc. No, I'm telling the truth. I stopped telling the truth, you can preach. But you ain't going to be up the rest of the night. I'm going to preach. You hear me now?
Not only as our generation, but God help us, our movement has gone to great lengths to prove and to validate and to lock up its constituency in the prison of testing.
Yeah, just play Billy Goat all you want to.
We have been cursed by modern day Nadabs and Abihus who concoct their own fire and put a religious flavor on it. We do not need any more paraded flesh. We do not need any more blessed talent. We need old-fashioned heaven's fire. We need a Holy Ghost fire. We need a descending of the God who is a consuming fire to set this thing in ablaze.
Please stay with me just a second. We have programs of flesh with religious overtones.
Uh-oh.
Masquerades, carnal counterfeiters, music with no message with no miracle. People among us that the day of the supernatural is over. I'm going to give you a kind declaration from a man from Brooklyn. Puke on you.
Puke on every spirit that says the supernatural is not for today. That's a lying devil. Jesus Christ has never changed. Jesus Christ has never diminished. He wants to heal. He wants to baptize. He wants to set on fire. He wants to deliver us from ourselves.
Now stay with me. Stay with me. Everything must be explained.
Everything has got to be validated. We got to have scripture verse for everything.
Oh, you're nuts. John was waiting for scripture verse. He never would have got in the spirit. He did that on his own. Now, I don't mind you quoting me, baby. Don't you misquote me. I got enough problems. We do not need Hollywood's help with this revival. We do not need to play and parade the glamour gospel. We do not need LA and all Hollywood's little theatrics. What we need, I've said it, I'm going to say it again. We need
meetings and churches that you just can't explain. I'm going to get downright nasty. When's the last time you acted where you couldn't explain? Why is it always the 16 people in your church that are wackos and you are solid word people? I'm a solid word man, but Jesus is the word. And we don't know Jesus any longer after the flesh. We know him after the spirit, and the spirit is life. Please be seated. Excuse me for making you do that. Pardon me. I don't mean to have a bad spirit, Brother Lumpkin. I've prayed and fasted and wept and slobbered and snotted and booed and cried and carried on. I checked every motive, every attitude, so I wouldn't be some facetious, rude slob getting up here trying to tell everybody something. I've agonized and checked my spirit, checked my motives, repented, prayed, resigned. Took the church back, resigned. Took the church back, resigned. Took the church back. Yes, I have. Laugh all you want to. I'm more honest than a lot of you. Our greatest need today is not trained talent and not natural oratory. We need supernatural stuff that you can't label. Well, I'm going to get way out there. We need some of you cats that never move to get your caucus moving. It's time to start talking in tongues. It's time to come to revelations and visions in the Holy Ghost. It's time to weep and cry and get emotional and get demonstrative. We've got to get involved. Get off your carcass, you prima donna. Be seated just a few more minutes here. You hear me now? What the Bible talks about those fellas. I wish to God that would go over our logos, Brother Becton. We have seen and heard strange things this day. Some of you cats, if you got out 15 minutes late on Sunday morning, you'd get voted out. We got to get delivered from this leaving on my mind spirit. When you come here, you ought not have leaving on your mind, my friend. We ought to have Jesus on our mind. We ought to have redemption. We ought to have redemption on our mind. We ought to have the power of God on our mind. We ought to have the edification of the church on our mind. We ought to have the majesty of the Lord on our mind. It ought to be a giant love affair. We don't want to leave. We want to stay. You want to leave because you're not in love. I don't get no letter from headquarters make me kiss Patty. I don't need them dudes to tell me about kissing Patty. She looks good, shaped good, smells good, kisses good. I don't need none of your jazz. I'm in love. I got built-in pucker power, Doc. You ain't gonna worry about me. Say what you want to, but a lot of our marriage is suffering because all you got is a sex relation. There needs to be something in us besides animal instinct. There needs to be a flow. You think I'm kidding you? We've got the most shallow, pretentious bunch of dinghies. Talked in tongues one time, piled their hair hot, adhesive tape their hank, their dress to their ankle, stood there, praised Jesus, loved Jesus, and man, they're as dead as a hammer. And they lived by that little book. Well, I didn't go here and didn't putt-putt golf, not against Little League, and just don't bowl, don't wear bowling shirts, don't watch. My God in heaven, have we traded the supernatural for ritual? You cannot legislate holiness. Holiness is an experience of the nature of God inside us. It's the nature of God that creates in us a want to. I want to be clean. I want to be holy because I love Him. Please be seated. You need to just sit down a while. You hear what I'm telling you. We're living in a generation that gears and catalogs and computerizes everything by the five senses. Touch and taste and see and hear and smell. But you can't do that with God because God is not physical. He is spiritual. Therefore, you cannot contact Him, nor can you govern Him with your five senses. It takes faith. Let me just say something. You know where philosophy comes from? Here's where philosophy comes from. Philosophy comes from honest men and women who have stood on the last frontier of revealed knowledge, wanting to know the why and the wherefore, but not understanding it to go across the chasm of that which is revealed and known. You must travel the bridge of faith. But to a man or a woman who lives only in the reason realm, faith does not compute. Therefore, reason burns the bridge down, and they step back on the last frontier, and they become philosophers. That's why we need faith. Faith takes us from as far as we've gone over to a dimension that you can't explain. That's why doctors and medical people and scientists, and God bless all these precious technological researchers and advances that we've made, but that's why we drive them screwy in the head. When they've had the analysis and they've had the test and the bone cancer and the marrow and this and that. And then you walk in and you're just a poor old dingy preacher walking in there. And here's all these intellectual giants with all their little boxes and all their little tubes and all their little neat stuff. And they're doing the best they can. God bless them for what they've done. And they walk out and they say, well, preacher, isn't this so stupid? Preacher. All this lady got now is God. You're in good hands with God. When there was nothing, this God made something. And I walked in to pray for a lady not too long ago on a kidney machine. One kidney was gone. She was on this dialysis thing. It was late at night. Didn't know the lady from Beans. Didn't know her. They just called and said, would you go pray for her? Walked in that little old corridor. Let me tell you something. Hospitals are hallways of doubt. They are hard places to release faith. Not because they're against what you believe, but they are children of reason. And reason is precious and good. It helps us. But when you need the miraculous, you've got to tell reason to go park. And I walked in that thing, and I'm no spiritual giant. I just walked in here, and it was like, beep, 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 beep. You watch that little. And every one of them says, you're a loser. You're a loser. Go ahead, you just lay your hand on her. We're going to put you in jail. Tubes up here. And every devil can ever belch out of hell goes around that bed and says, show us your stuff, Jeffy. Show us your stuff, Jeffy. Come on, Jeffy, this ain't Alec. This ain't because of the times. Show us your stuff. Beep, 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 beep. Such as I have. Was mine. I said, I have it. It was a gift given to me. It's not mine. Why look ye on me as if by my holiness or my power? He is the creator. He is the savior. He is the power. Such as I have, give I unto thee. You think I'm kidding you? Well, I prayed for her, Anthony. That thing went beep, 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 beep. And the kidney that was dead came alive. In 2 days, she came out of the hospital. I didn't stay to get my picture taken, Billy. I just prayed and went on. You're not hearing me. God is challenging this movement, not this little meeting, this movement. We need to get to the place that things cannot be explained, but they cannot be denied. And that's going to take bold, courageous faith. Please be seated just another minute. What will attract the crowd? We try everything from Dan to Beersheba. I'll tell you what'll attract the crowd. Set the joint on fire. You think I'm kidding you? You let a fire come down in this place and watch disinterested people come out. Watch her burn. Well, I'm going to get downright nasty. Boy, I wonder what they'd do if some of us preachers caught on fire. When's the last time you cats preached and spit and slobbered and screamed and carried on and ruined the King's English?
Well, I'm a word man.
God, we need a baptism of fire. We need Elijah's God to send down the supernatural and deliver us from this fakery and this chicanery and this plastic Pentecostal junk. Please be seated. I'm having a hard time getting through this here. What will bring a crowd? Fire. The miraculous. The supernatural. Simply stated, God enthroned. Our problem is we got long distance deity.
Well, just get quiet all you want to.
We're playing the same game that Israel did. They called for the Ark of the Covenant to come into the camp. And when the Ark came in, they did their thing. And God wasn't in the Ark, and God wasn't in the people, and God wasn't in the camp, and they were still doing their thing. And the Philistines were unimpressed. They beat their brains in. Because sometimes we suffer from just possessing the symbol, and God is speaking to us. Why not possess the substance? While we pat ourselves on the back and say, God has given us the truth. Really? Truth is more than doctrine, honey bun. Truth is a person. Jesus said, I am the truth, singular possessor.
Oh, I believe Acts 2:38. Well, how come you live like an idiot?
I'll tell you why. You can believe doctrine and not know deity. You can quote the book and not know the author. I'm not trying to belabor this, but you asked me to preach. Let me tell you something. Have we traded our faith for facts? Are we concerned with the explanation rather than the transformation, regeneration, and the future translation? Everybody say, he's going to get downright nasty now. in order not to offend the thinkers among us, the calculators among us, the baptized brains among us, the wealthy, the successful, the business folks, we tend to bend and blend. We have someone who could put a rocket on the moon. Therefore, we change our approach so we can reach him intellectually. Honey, I'm the most negative intellectual person, and I'm going past the moon. I got the Holy Ghost, Brother Kilgore, like you got. Like you got. Before I finish, I want a little bit of that jazz you do. That's what I want. Come on. Come on. You guys gave us this truth. Just another few minutes. We reach for the approval of the wrong crowd. We have given birth to a generation of Obadiahs who work with Ahab but don't irritate him. Why raise hell with Ahab? We're trying to win him to heaven. As for me in my house, I'll be an Elijah, and I'm going to irritate the slob. Now, you missed what I just said, so I'll bring it out so it's real plain. There is no such thing as revival with peaceful coexistence with Ahab. Ahab is a backslider. Ahab used to be one God. Ahab married that old witch Jezebel. And Obadiah is trying to work inside. Now listen to me. That doesn't mean Obadiah doesn't do neat things because he saved a bunch of prophets one time. But what's the benefit of saving prophets who died during a water drought? Why not be an Elijah and get a rainstorm? For Ahab doesn't care whether you live, Obadiah. Read this story. The scripture says he sent Obadiah out to find grass for his animals, not you. Honey, when push comes to shove, Ahab's going to kill you, Obadiah. You're only living cool by the palace because you won't rub the slob. And here comes old Elijah walking up and just saying, "How you doing, Ahab? Art thou him that troubled Israel?" "I ain't troubled Israel, you slime bucket. You troubled Israel, you backslidden dirty dog. Couldn't tell the truth standing on the Bible looking at God." "Well, I'm just going to tell you, be my last, I'm for war. Ye that love the Lord, hate evil. Ye that love the Lord, hate evil. Love the sinner, but hate sin. Love the lost world, but hate worldliness. Ye that love the Lord, hate evil." I don't know how long I've been. Okay. I'm just going to tell you this and I'll go on. Who cares what the world thinks anyway? Them slobs killed Jesus. What do you care whether the world thinks you're a neat dude or not? The world has always hunted and hated the holy. The world has always killed God's preachers and prophets and his saints. Why do we always want to acquiesce to these guys as if somehow we could get an in with them? You want to get an in with them? Shut up, heaven. He'll come looking for you.
I'm not hurting you. I'm not hurting you. Okay. Our lives ought to magnify the miraculous mercy we've obtained. Our lives must be a confirmation and not a contradiction. Our lips and our lives must speak the same things. Now please forgive me if I sound negative, but true preaching is always positive. We can have no revival until we are baptized with honesty. If we are liars, we need to ask God to forgive us. Yeah, it's going to get quiet as hell is hot. If you have immoral imaginations, turn off the tube and get saved. Don't watch stuff and listen to stuff and read stuff that can cultivate an unclean imagination, because the devil works with your brain. We shouldn't expose ourselves to stuff that can sexually arouse us and bring impure thoughts and impure motives and impure drives. Come on, why don't you say amen to it? These precious old men that preached the truth to us, they were prophets at heart. They knew our generation was going to be like this. Sit down, please. We are allowing things in our lives. We are allowing things in our lives that this very conference has indicted us and said, Jeffrey Wayne, you've got no right to preach. You're guilty. And I said, I know I am. I will do better. I promise. I will look at areas in my life and I will crush them and kill them, and I'll put on that sack. But what good is it if we talk in tongues and juke and jam and bang into the walls and tell everybody about the great message we got in the truth and go home and live like a bunch of dirty dogs? We do things hidden in our homes. We watch things, listen to things, read things, indulge in things that if Jesus Christ was sitting there, he'd embarrass the living daylights out of us. God is calling us to purity. God is calling us to honesty. God is wanting us to have integrity. Not just talking in tongues, integrity. The supernatural must be among us so natural. Paul writes to the Galatian church in chapter 3 and says, have you begun in the spirit that you're now perfected, made complete and whole by the flesh? What was he saying? Did you start out supernaturally and then write you a book of rules and now that's going to perfect you? So, oh man, this cat's liberal. I ain't liberal. I'm straight as an arrow. But we must understand something. We cannot legislate law. We do need law. But we cannot enforce law by a hammer. You cannot tell what people will do in the secret of their own confines of their homes and where they're off and what they do. Somehow or another, we've got to trust people. Somehow we've got to let people say, well, now, God, is this good or bad? And that doesn't give some bimbos a license to withstand the preacher. If your preacher becomes an active conscience for your church and says, we feel it's best in the integrity of this church not to indulge in this, this, and this, tough. You got to stop. Even if you don't believe it, do it unto the Lord. Have a submissive spirit. Surrender. Don't be a rebel at heart. They watch for your soul. They watch for your soul. Oh God. Oh God. Jesus' whole life was totally unexplainable, yet undeniable. Consider his birth. Explain to me, you great computer scientist, God as a fetus. Show me deity in disguise. Show me, explain to me, divinity as dust, the creator as clay, the father in flesh. It's not hard to understand the oneness of God. It's that philosophical mystery stuff that gets people's brains all screwy. Never did understand that crazy doctrine that people talk about, that one God sent the other God to get bumped off because the one God liked the kids. I'm trying to be kind, Radio Land. I've often thought, if the father loved James Kilgore so much, why don't the father come and get bumped off? Leave the kid alone. That is the dumbest doctrine. That the father is sitting in this box or this throne and says, man, I love all those little animals down there that can't help themselves. You get yourself on down there and get bumped off for them because I love them.
Some things that are big problems, they'll send a field representative to help you. But when it gets totally out of hand, they'll send the president of the corporation. This thing was so far out of hand, he didn't send the representatives, he came himself. Jesus Christ was God manifest in the flesh. He was the Father walking among us. It was the president of the corporation.
Be seated just a minute and I'll finish. How in the name of God, Bishop Urshan, could we ever have such an unthinkable, unexplainable, dingbat doctrine that you could be eternal and begotten? Imbecilic. If you're eternal, you're eternal. No beginning, no end. If you're begotten, you come into existence. Did Jesus pre-exist? Yes. Not as the Son, as the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was made flesh. My Father that dwells in me, he does the work. I and my Father are one. He that seen me has seen the Father. All Jesus Christ was God's house. What do you think you are, flesh? His whole life was filled with astonishment everywhere he went. In Matthew 15, the Bible said he threw all the sick and the lame at his feet and he astonished the crowds because he healed them all. And they went away wondering to himself. Why? They couldn't explain but couldn't deny. Problem with us, they can come and sit their carcass in our church for weeks and weeks and months and can explain everything. And then every once in a while we get somebody start doing the Watusi among us. Or doing one of them Kohichi Comanche. Ow! And the Word people go. I'd like for God to shake the falsehood out of us. I'd like for God to shake us real good and deliver us from hypocrisy and fakery and shallow Pentecost. We've got a treasure in earthen vessels. Why do we treat it like junk? Okay, just another minute or two. He went and turned water to wine. He fed multitudes with fishes and loaves. Cripples were healed. They came through the roof. The scripture says in Mark 2, they were astonished beyond measure. And all men glorified God. Now you hear me, Stone King. Empty wheelchairs glorify God. Not tubes up your nose. Not braces on your legs. Not breathing machines on your lungs. Empty wheelchairs.
Empty caskets. Blind eyes, boom. Deaf ears, boom. Dumb tongues speak. The lame leap and walk. Read the scripture that I read to you in Acts 3. This cat gets to leaping and jumping and juking around. Son, he's wacko. He's out of space. He's from another dimension. Why not? The power from another dimension just made him that way. Hey, it made you and I that way when we first got started. What happened? What happened to us? You open the blind eyes, loose the deaf ears, loose the tongues, cast out devils with his word, put the seas to sleep, walked on the water, cleansed lepers. My God, if you think I'm unique, I'm strange, Ray Perry, your spiritual dad is way out there. Find in the book where he's talking to a tree. Who do you follow? I follow Jesus. You mean the one that talks to trees? He walks by a tree. Hear me now. He's going to get a little rough right now. All he found on the tree was nice leaves, sort of like us, beautiful but barren. He's not happy with how pretty the tree looks. He could care less how much shade the tree gives. He's wanting fruit. Fruit, 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 fruit. It's got to produce. It's got to produce. It's got to produce. It's got to produce. If it doesn't produce, he's going to talk to that tree and he's going to curse it. Please be seated. Seems strange to me, brother. He talked to a tree and it died. He talked to dead Lazarus and he lived. You found a strange person. Can you imagine all the people that passed Jesus that day when he walked by and they were all going by with his little band of unemployed Jews? He's going to build a church. What's he do? He tells them all to quit their job. He's got 11 unemployed Jews and one devil. And what are you trying to do? You work a second job to keep you out of church. Seek you first the kingdom. Seek you first the kingdom. Seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. God will bless. God will add. God is faithful. We're not serving a liar. He is the faithful God. He is the true God. He is the living God. His promises are yea and amen. Just a few more minutes and I'm finished. We are so worried about explanation that we have forfeited a demonstration. Hear me now, Stone King. Hear me, Prophet Barnes. Hear me, Busted Boys. Hear me now. And if we have anyone around us who yearns and desires and tries to work in the supernatural, we scrutinize and we shoot at and we pick apart, not because we're against the miraculous, but to justify our own uninvolvement. We have men and women who are seeking the depths of God, who are trying to operate in these gift ministries. Thank you, Jesus. And I see people that they have to fight. They're not fighting sinners. They're fighting saints who are wallpaper for Jesus, who stand and watch and say, well, I'll see if it works. You little jerk. We don't need any more critics. We need people who release their faith. have churches, we have huge districts that do not operate even in the gifts of the Spirit. What in the name of God is wrong with us? Have we begun in the Spirit and are now perfected by the flesh? Have we learned the little doctrines that keep us safe from putt-putt golf and Little League baseball? We hide behind this little stuff and we say, oh, I got the Holy Ghost. You do. When's the last time you talked in tongues? You ever have come to visions and dreams? You ever just squall and bawl and agonize and cry? Don't even know why. Have you ever just rode down the street and all of a sudden for no reason? Man, you just begin to weep and cry and you get into the Spirit without doing anything. You don't need a choir. You don't need anything. It's just the Spirit just goes, whoosh. Is that foreign to us that God put us on our faces tonight? God put us on our faces tonight that somehow we would agonize and break through to a dimension of the Spirit that we tell everybody we've got. Oh boy. Pick apart people who are trying. I am insane. I know that. I am. I realize that. And my time is gone. And I'm. Let me tell you why I'm crazy. Let me tell you why I'm nuts. Why your opinion don't mean squat to me. I was a drunk. I smoked 50 cigars every 2 weeks, 2 packs of Salems a day. I drank 2 to 3 bottles of Caballero and Bacardi rum every weekend. I honky-tonked, I whored, I played cards, I partied. Mahaney ain't the only cat that's been in jail. Patty Arnold and I were getting divorced. 1 year, 4 years during Vietnam, I'm home. And Patty is tired of a drunk. And during the night, he came to me. I didn't know anything about God, Bishop. I've been to Baptist church. My mom was a Catholic. I've been to Presbyterian. I was baptized in a Presbyterian. I've been to the Lutheran church. I've been to the Episcopalian church. I got saved in Billy Graham's crusades before Mr. Billy Graham was even a big deal. I was one of the first people that was ever there when he first came to Madison Square Garden. I was one of the people that went down the aisle to accept Jesus. By the time I got out of high school, I had a stack of cards that big in my wallet for accepting Jesus. I would accept Jesus as my personal Savior and steal the tires off the back end of a car. I would get under conviction. I'd repent. I'd go back again. I'd accept Jesus. Forgive me, Jesus. And I'd sign a card. I'd make my personal commitment. 2 weeks later, I'd be whoring around, honky-tonking somewhere. I finally gave up on myself and said, I can't be saved. There's something wrong with me. I'm just a devil. I don't have what these people have. They seem so happy and joyous and thrilled. They just sign cards and whoopee, they're just on their way to Jubilee. And I keep getting drunk and honky-tonking and shooting pool and playing cards. And I'm a wacko. And during the night, all of a sudden, 3 o'clock in the morning, I sat up in bed, straight up in bed. Thought I heard a door rattle. Didn't understand the presence in the house. I got up, I lit up a cigarette, I walked around, I popped a can of beer. I checked the doors, I walked back and forth. I was wide awake. What is going on? Tingly, feeling hair, goosebumps. Smoked a while, put the beer back, went back to bed. The next night, 3 in the morning, sat up in the bed, lit up a cigarette, drank a beer, walked back and forth. Third night, voice, Jeffrey, you're just about out of time. You have an opportunity now to change your life. Terrified me. Didn't know anything about you Pentecostals. I began to cry and weep. I walked in and talked to Patty. She was sound asleep. Appreciate the humor of this. 3 a.m. We're getting divorced. I'm a drunk. I'm a liar. I couldn't tell the truth standing on the Bible looking at Jesus. And I went over to Patty and I said, Patty, what if God were to call me to be a missionary to China, would you go? She said, missionary, China, my God, you're bomb, go back to bed. I looked at her and said, no, Patty, God, I think it's God, is dealing with me. We need to go to church. No Pentecostal. But I worked with a precious Baptist man who went to Anita Bryant's Baptist Church in Northwest 54th Street in North Miami. We went, big church, so crowded they were in the aisles. I had to sit in the back and Patty sat up in front of me. They gave the altar call, and please forgive me, Radio Land. I don't know how else to say this, but it was just kind of a Billy Graham special. I've been through about 30 or 40 of them. It's standard stuff. Another sign, the card, another flop. And all of a sudden, Patty came back. Billy, Patty came back, slobbering, crying, weeping. She said, go with me to the altar. It was 7,000 miles to the altar. We were clear in the back of the tabernacle. I said, down there. She said, come on, it's our only hope. And I walked down there. Now you understand, I've been there 100 times. I knelt down. She knelt down. I began to pray. All I knew was Playboy magazine, cigars, 5-card poker. Little fella come up and said, do you believe in Jesus? I said, that's why I'm here. I said, do you know you're a sinner? I said, of course I'm a sinner. I don't need you, Flash. I know I'm a sinner. He said, if you'll just pray this prayer, and I'm saying this not to ridicule anybody that believes this. I'm giving you an honest truth. He said, if you'll just pray this prayer. I knew what was coming. I had 30 cards. Lord Jesus, I believe you died for my sins. I believe you died for my sins. And I confess that I'm a sinner without hope, without help. I confess that I'm a sinner without hope, without help. And I accept you as my personal Savior. And I accept you as my personal Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Praise God, Brother Jeff, you just got saved. And I was crushed. I said, oh, God, not again. And I looked at him and said, aren't you thrilled? I said, are you trying to tell me I just met the Creator? I just met him that spoke nothing and it became something. You mean I just met him? I said, oh yeah, we're saved by faith. Little Patty's on the other side. Little different story with the little freckle-faced redhead who doesn't say 5 words a year. When the little Weasley fellow walked up and said, do you believe in Jesus? Stop praying. Just say this prayer. Then she dropped the hand grenade in the small bathroom. Because then she unleashed the fury and said, saved. Saved. Well, I haven't even got the Holy Ghost yet. I haven't started talking in tongues yet. And that fella said, tongues, saved, Holy Ghost. Wait a minute. They got 5 deacons up, began to counsel, began to deal with us. I've been thrown out of whorehouses, hotels. I've been thrown out of bars. I've been thrown out of places. I have never been thrown out of a church till this morning. And while they began to convince her there was no such thing as the Holy Ghost talking in tongues, and you got saved just by mental gymnastics, all of a sudden she just revolted in front of these people and began to talk to them. And the pastor turned and said, would you please escort this couple out of my sanctuary? They are disturbing my service. Now let's all pray that they'll accept Jesus. We went to the back little room and they began to counsel with us. Little did I know that in Patty's childhood, after her mother had died and her dad had become an alcoholic, she had been given away with her sisters and brothers to numerous orphanages. But one of those orphanages, an aunt came to in Toledo, Ohio, and adopted her out. And did I not know, but as a child, she was raised in Fred Kinsey's church. And now, all of a sudden, they are saying, no tongues, no Jesus name baptism, no Holy Ghost talking in tongues. And the truth that for 15 years is lying dormant in her soul. She says, you are lying. You are lying. When I was a little girl, I saw people get the Holy Ghost. I saw people receive the supernatural inundation of the power of God. I know the Holy Ghost is real. And I am in this truth because a Sunday school teacher had a burden and taught the truth. And the truth brought me as a piece of fruit. So I cannot buy this little low stuff. I am a miracle. Stan, there's no need for me to preach anymore. I have a page of notes. I don't need to preach anymore. I have told you three words. Unexplainable, but undeniable. And if your life and my life are not under that banner, I will not accuse us of being fakes. That would be too unkind. I will just say, we need some adjustments in our lives. We need to step up to the supernatural. Does not the Bible say that Apollos was a mighty man in the Scriptures? He was eloquent. He was trained in the ways of the Lord. Watch this. Knowing only the baptism of John. Are we trying to do the work of God with water when what we need is fire? For John baptized with water unto repentance, but Jesus baptizes with the Holy Ghost and fire. And water can wash a lot of things, but fire is the greater of the two cleansing agents. Fire can burn down where those things on the surface are hidden. My last word to you, those of you who are Jonah, you've made a wrong decision. You've headed the wrong way. And you've forgotten the supernatural. How stupid, Jonah, to think that you could run from God when God can create wind. But see, when your mentality is out of that avenue, you do stupid things. But as I sat on the platform, Brother David, I felt a word from the Lord that I wrote down in my notes. And it's simply in Jonah 4 and verse 1. For after Jonah had made his mistake and judgment had fallen and he was in that first submarine, the Scripture says he repents in his place of mistake and says, salvation is of the Lord. Watch this. He opened his mouth in confession. God opens his mouth in authority. And the prison opened its mouth and gave liberty. And the Scripture concludes the story in 4 and 1 simply saying, and the word of the Lord came unto Jonah a second time. It is no mystery to me, Billy Cole, Lee Stone, King Bill Sisko, David Fuller and the gang, that all that's moving right now to take us into the unexplainable has focused on this moment. For we are the Jonah, not in total disregard and running away, but doing the best we can, but allowing spirits among us to bring us down to the level of the mediocre, where we do not ripple anybody's little balloon. And the word of the Lord is coming to us a second time again.